Into this artistic melting pot stepped arguably the greatest American composer of the 20th century. And he took swing to a whole new level. Edward Kennedy Ellington's natural grace had earned him the nickname Duke at the age of 7. He was born into a middle-class household in Washington, D.C. and moved to New York in 1923 when he heard Fletcher Henderson's band, with its complex interplay between instruments, he knew that swing was the perfect new framework for his own refined style of music.
The thing that made Duke Ellington unique was that he really discovered how to blend the refined and the raw perfectly.
It was a devastating combination. By the late 20s, swing was by far the dominant form of jazz.
Ellington and the rest of them were really taking over. A jazz band that was a swing band, it was a dance band, it wasn't pure jazz. And a lot of the early jazz fans were very well aware of this. And they said, this stuff that's being played by Ellington or Henderson is not the true jazz. The true jazz is the New Orleans jazz. It didn't matter. The New Orleans jazz was dead. And whatever kind of jazz you're going to have was going to be played in the context of a big dance band.
You know, sometimes a tune just comes into you and knocks you down.
Yeah.
You can't resist it, and you just have to put it down. And usually it associates someone, itself with some specific performer in the band.
You could take any 18-piece orchestra, 15, 18-piece orchestra, and line them up and have them to play one of Ellington's charts, and then have Ellington's band play it, and it wouldn't swing as much, because Duke knew how to use the people that he had in his band.
Some members of Ellington's band stayed with him for 45 years.
What is the secret of keeping a band together for as long as you do? Because
well, you've got to have a gimmick, Humphrey. It's the one I use. I mean, I use a gimmick. Huh?
Yeah.
Just give them money.
Yes, I can see that's very popular.
Oh.
because he had the same people in the group for a long time. That meant that you got this, not only a consistency of sound, but in the end, the thing that I'm starting to achieve with my band, although my big band has been, I suppose, going for maybe 10, 15 years, is they start thinking as one, and so you don't no longer have to explain things. Some things you write an arrangement out, other things you just start playing, and people find parts that are actually better than the ones you write out, because the band thinks as one. And not only could his band, if they wanted to, they could play the blues and swing that straight away if they wanted to, but they could go off in all sorts of other tangents. But it always had what the Ellingtonian thing was. You could always tell it was him.
Many of the techniques Ellington expected of his band had previously been the preserve of classical musicians. Circular breathing, for example, a fiendishly difficult technique that allowed brass players in his band to sustain a note indefinitely.
You take an intake of air through your nostril. And while you're breathing that air through your nostril into your lungs, your jaws are filled with air. You push the jaws like that, so it's like. And at the same time, you have to realize, I haven't played in a couple of days, so I don't have any amateur, but you have to buzz. Keep a buzz and keep your chops buzzing like that, you could go on forever.
Don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing.
It was Duke Ellington who first noticed that swing was a bit more than just a form of music.
It don't mean a thing, all you gotta do is swing.
Swing was the music of black self-expression. But most importantly of all, it was dance music. And on the dance floor, anyone was free to get up and let themselves go.
Don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing.
You're dancing to the beat. And that's what it was. It was the beat. And everything in life got a beat. And that's what swing was. I mean, you couldn't listen to the music and not dance to it.
Throughout the 1920s, dance had remained one of the key forms of entertainment for black and white audiences in America. Crazes had come and gone, but the most popular dance of the decade had been the Charleston. Young white college students had scandalized their elders by wildly jigging about or flapping. This dance was taken by African-American audiences and adapted to suit their music, swing. The resulting dance, the Lindy Hop, was a careful combination of the organized and the improvised. The most famous dance troupe of the day was Whitey's Lindy Hoppers, and Norma Miller, born in 1919, was one of its key members. They were the resident dancers at the Temple of Swing Dancing, the Savoy Ballroom in Harlem.
Dark Harlem's hot and noisy Savoy.
Well, I was 12. I wasn't supposed to be there, but I got in there because of Twist My George. That was Easter Sunday, and they had a matinee, and and you left church and you went up to Harlem because you wanted to see the Easter parade. And that was the time coming out the winter coats and things, and you saw clothes that you couldn't believe. And this was an Easter Sunday, and I was standing outside the Savoy because I wanted to see the people going in. They were dressed up, and this man called me and wanted me to, you know, when the music started playing, I was out there dancing in the street like all kids. And he asked me to come up and dance with him at the Savoy Ballroom. Well, this is what we did 7 days a week. We had to learn a routine. We were trained like athletes. I mean, this was every day, rehearsing, till we became the best in the world. We were just the best. Your life began with swing.
For large swathes of America, however, the open exuberance of swing dancing confirmed their opinion that this latest form of jazz was a threat to the nation's morals. Worse still, it thrived in the illegal drinking clubs or speakeasies that flourished in the Prohibition era.
The speakeasies did a land office business. Texas Guinan with her gals kept customers roaring.
Duke Ellington was the star turn at Harlem's legendary Cotton Club, a few hundred yards from the Savoy Ballroom. The Cotton Club was owned by British-born gangster Oney Madden, one of New York's most influential and violent citizens.
Jazz has always originated in places that allowed it to nurture. Like, and it was always in either in whorehouses, nightclubs that had a lot of drinking, had a lot of dancing, but most of all, places that were run by the rackets, gangsters, basically. And they loved jazz musicians because it was happy music that made people feel good. And for some reason, I never knew any jazz musicians that worked in those places that had any trouble with the gangsters at all.
We were in the Cotton Club for 5 years. Mm. We had a wonderful spot. It was owned by people who were very influential and prestigious with having things accomplished. And the great thing was about it that when the show on, and they did have a wonderful show, no one was allowed to talk. And some guy would start talking, and the waiter would come on, sir, would you please? And then the next thing, he'd go on, and the next thing, the captain would come over. And the next thing you know, the head waiter would come. And then the next thing you know, the guy would just disappear.
That, of course, was the Prohibition era, wouldn't it?
Yes.
By that time, yeah. Did you have any trouble with federal agents or anything like that?
Federal agents? Yeah? No, I didn't. There was never anything left for them to confiscate.